already today. Tremendous upheaval has happened already today. Was in a store yesterday, and there was this song playing. Some, what was it? Grocery store, some kind of store. And I said, that song sounds familiar. And then I got it. I said, oh, I know what that is. And I listened to the lyrics and got to believe in magic. Nothing can stand in our way. Xanadu, Olivia Newton-John. I said, whoa. Listen to those lyrics. Listen to how seductive it is. Got to believe in magic. You know, it's a very, very, very seductive song. And it brought back memories of just how, what extraordinarily pressure we've been under in every single way in this world to be seduced into self-delusion and to believe in magic. And this morning I was doing an intense neither nor session, fantastic. And then once I got up and started moving around the day, this song came back, and it's trying to call me like a siren song. You know, you got to believe in magic. You got to believe in magic. You got to believe in time. Then I pulled this book off the shelf, Prophecies by D.K. It's a theosophical book. When I was young, I read all the theosophical books because that's what everybody said was the best teaching in the world. And I found myself becoming extremely depressed, feeling very disempowered. It was horrible. But all the spiritual heavyweights that I was aware of, they all said, oh, this is the highest teaching in the world. If you're really spiritual, this is what you'd be studying and believing in. And I went down into a black hole from reading all that stuff. Finally, I had to stop. And I felt like, wow, I must be totally a total spiritual loser. You know, total spiritual loser. I can't hang with this stuff. And then I came across A Course in Miracles. And from that very moment, I felt that I've been spiritually empowered. I felt every time I read A Course in Miracles, Journey Beyond Words, or listen to the Holy Spirit, I feel spiritually empowered. Now, just looking at that theosophy book again, it's just like, ugh, you know, spiritual disempowerment. Wow. It's really quite extraordinary. And yet, it's so slick and sophisticated, Dracul's words, you know, group synthesis. We're going to enter this age of light, a new age of unbelievable spiritual awareness through group synthesis. And, you know, so they have this belief that everything's going to become unbelievably great, you know, and yet, if you look at the rhetoric, the overall rhetoric of it, you know, you just say, this doesn't quite add up, you know. In some way, it seems deficient. And then you listen to what Jesus has to say, and Jesus doesn't say anything like this whatsoever. No similarities. Or, same with Longchenpa. It doesn't say the same thing at all. And yet, Dwakul is supposed to be a you know, some very high, you know, head of some high monastery in Tibet was supposed to be. So you think, you know, he's in part of the Great White Brotherhood and, you know, aware of the future and all. So you think he's super, super, super advanced spiritual master. And yet what Jesus says doesn't have any correlation really with what the theosophy is saying. So there's this incredible disconnect going on, a spiritual disconnect. Who's right? And it's just been some horrible, horrible experience in this world because no one has clarified it, really. The disconnect is so severe that to not notice this and not say anything about it is just extraordinary. No spiritual teacher has said anything about this. I mean, the entire planet is now following the path of theosophy under the guise of Agenda 21, okay? And the United Nations. This is the future here. This is the future. There's no question about it. And yet, the non-dual teachings from the great non-duals like Longchenpa, like Jesus, like Buddha, like Sri Anandamayi Ma, like Ramana Maharshi, Nisargadatta Maharaj, etc., 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 they don't say anything like what theosophy is saying. So there is this vast, vast disconnect going on that is just tormenting us. But, you know, for me, I don't want any part of the future of these people. I mean, I just went through a technological nightmare this morning, just trying to get reservations. Comcast came out to our house. They fixed one thing, and they ended up disconnecting something else. They left our fax machine, the phone line, other phone line doesn't work. And we made an appointment. They say we lost the appointment, no record of it. We're waiting for the appointment today. They never show up. We call again, try to reschedule again. It's a nightmare going through all this stuff. Who knows if it'll be able to fix it? They say, yeah, we fixed one thing, but something else is broken. I try to make reservations on the phone at a restaurant. Can't get through to anyone. You have to leave a voicemail. I did that before. No one ever got back to me. Called another restaurant. Another voicemail couldn't get through to anybody. I mean, you can't even get through to restaurants. I hate this modern world and technology. Sure, there's some nice factors like anything. I mean, they put poison in a pretty bottle, you know? So, oh, it's a nice bottle, nice stopper, you know, like the label on the bottle. It's just cool. But inside is poison. I mean, so, you know, technology to me is poison. It's terrible. Can't wait to get free of it. Cannot wait to get free of it. Okay, but here's the problem. Now, the Holy Spirit has never let me down. Okay, thank God for the Holy Spirit. Because it gave me this practice this morning, keep practicing this, and it was a fantastic practice, just wonderful, about abidance, okay, abidance. This is really the goal. Not to try to keep working on synthesizing forms and such. Whatever that is, abidance is still our goal, okay. Ramana Maharshi, he's telling us true, okay. He's saying this world is nothing. It has no value whatsoever. Form has no value, whatever. Same with Jesus. I believe they're telling us true. And what the Tibetan is telling us is, you know, I wish Jesus would speak up by the Holy Spirit and say, look, this, but maybe we cannot understand. They must, you know, have our best interests at heart. But, you know, but it's frustrating to say the very least. Because, we're living here in this make-believe world. And we're believing in a future, and you know, but it's out of our hands. It's going in this dystopian, horrible way, and yet the young people just think it's wonderful, you know. So we're you know, completely not in sync at all, and you know, they're just basically writing off the older generation completely. This is their attitude. Oh, these people were like in a different world, different universe, different dimension. They have nothing to do with us, and you know, there's no sense of continuity there at all. It's like their world, take it or leave it. So, how about leaving it? Yeah, we'll take that option. We'll bring up whatever option the Holy Spirit tells us to do. We're not going to let them dictate what our options are, to say the least. Nor will we let Jwakul and Theosophy dictate what our options are. Okay? So, the neither nor practice, I've continue to work at this, okay? Continue to work at this. This is an extraordinary practice. And it, you know, it gets my attention. That's why I keep doing it. I keep going deeper, and I keep using it in better and better and better ways. It's just like, you know, I always think that musicians have an advantage on the spiritual path, given that if they switch over to the spiritual path, because they can use their experience with music to practice effectively. If you're a really good musician, you know you cannot just do rote practice, you know. That's not going to make you great at all. You have to engage yourself and your creativity and your willingness and do it this way, try it this way. And this is what makes you, you know, shine as a really great musician. You get out of it what you put into it. You're not some robot that is just doing notes. So if you transfer this over to spiritual practice, you will find that you're able to do it, and you realize, wow, this is really getting me somewhere, because I'm not just some robot here. I'm using my creativity. I'm using my engagement with this. And creative people of all realms that have really excelled, you know, they can transfer this ability over to the spiritual path. And they will get it. They will understand that you go up and down in practice, like musicians, they know sometimes their practice is just scintillating, sometimes it's flat, but they have to stay with it, and you have to push through the good times and the bad times, and not get frustrated. Not, you know, it takes great discipline to be a really great musician. You can't get frustrated, so just transfer all that onto the spiritual path. Don't try to do both either. You know, you'll fail at both. You know, to be a great musician, you have to be totally committed to it. To succeed on the spiritual path, you have to be totally committed to it. You cannot You cannot excel at both. It doesn't work that way. So I said goodbye to music, you know. Absolutely, I did. But I'm using all of the discipline and capabilities I developed in music. Now I'm using it on the spiritual path. You know, you get it first thing in the morning. You know, if you really want to be a great musician, you get up in the morning, you practice for 5 hours, right? Just to keep yourself going forward, right? Same thing with spiritual path. You wake up, you know, you may do 2 hours, 3 hours, 4 hours, whatever. I wake up early in the mornings, lie in bed, and work, practice. You have to truly engage with it. You cannot just say, okay, it's in a book, tell me what to do, I need to say this, okay. You have to make it your own, you know, like a musician, nobody can play for you. You know, you're at the piano, you have to play it. And people are going to hear what you play. So you have to make the instrument, the piano, you know, and you have to be friends. You know, you got to be buddies. You've got to say, this is my realm. This is what I do. This is what I'm in sync with. Same thing with spiritual practice. You have to say, this is what I'm in sync with. This is what I do. This is my passion. This is what I'm dedicated to, you know, bringing this through to true virtuosity. I'm going to play as best as I can. If you got an audience there and you're playing the piano, boy, you better focus in and knock it out of the park. Same with spiritual practice. There's no audience there, but you are the audience, actually. You are your own audience. So you need to really work at it, really play with it, really say, hey, let me try this. You know, neither nor this way. Well, let me try it this way. I wonder if it sounds better this way, or I wonder if it's more effective this way. And you just become very creative, like, huh. You keep your attention on it. Like, I'm neither a failure at the past and future, nor am I not a failure at the past and future. I'm neither a success at past and future, nor am I not a success at past and future, doing the past and future dance, you see. I'm neither a success, nor am I not a success. I neither am an achiever, nor am I not an achiever. And you say these, and say this, and really mean it. And sort of feel like a musician. How do musicians get good? Don't they listen to what they're playing? And they play something, they say, how does that sound? You know, what's my feeling? How do I feel about what I just played? And they say, well, you know, that was really good. I like it. Or I'm going to modify it a little bit. You have to have your own feedback. The same thing on the spiritual path. You have to be aware of your own feedback. Now, if you're a musician on drugs, you know, you say, oh, everything sounds great, man, you know. But other people may be saying, wow, you know, that's sloppy and it doesn't sound very good at all. But if you're on drugs, you think it all sounds good. This is fooling yourself. So you have to be stone cold sober at all times. And so what you hear and the mood that you hear is accurate, you know. It's accurate feedback. So then you can adjust and get better and better and better and better and better. If you're on drugs, you don't get better. You don't really get better. You just keep using more drugs because they say, well, it sounds even better now because I'm even on more drugs. But your playing, you know, goes to hell. You see people on drugs, they've a long time, they're playing, you just say, wow, you know. But they think it sounds great. So, and of course, they want everybody else to be on drugs too, so they'll think it's great. Hey, what's wrong with my audience? You don't like this? Here, take a bunch of drugs and you'll think it's great too. So musicians on drugs tend to lead people into drug abuse, no question about it. Very bad influence on the world. Musicians in general are very dangerous. Stay away from them unless they've truly repented. And if they truly repented, they probably are not musicians anymore, actually. They realize, hey, the spiritual path is where it's at. And let's get into that full blast here. I'm no longer... You know, you can't be a virtuoso in both directions. Virtuoso means you've committed. You're really committed, exclusively committed to it. So you can't be exclusively committed to two different, you know, things, really. Not really. So I say stay away from musicians that are practicing musicians. Ex-musicians who have repented are really good, I would say, because they understand, you know, they're able to really work at the path, very committed. The neither nor practice is feeling more and more and more and more effective and relevant and wow. And I was able to directly work on this light versus dark thing that took me out of abidance before, and you know, evaporate more and more and more concern and fear out. It's an evaporative agent. This neither nor practice evaporates our continuity fear when we apply it to our inner concerns. We have to be aware of what our inner concerns are and then apply it to that, to those inner concerns. So it's a creative endeavor. You have to be engaged and aware, what are my inner concerns? And then be creative enough to apply this practice to those concerns. You cannot just listen to someone else and do exactly by rote what they say. It's like having a piece of music and you just play the piano. Okay, I played the notes. You know, no. That's not really, you know, that's not what a virtuoso really does. They you know, make the music their own. Okay. It's coming from them, from within them. It's not a player piano. And in fact, if they're playing some music and they feel like they could do something else that's even better, they'll actually just shift off to playing that. Really, seriously. It's like, hey, this song's nice, but inspiration just hit me, and I'm gonna do that. And if the audience is hip enough, you know, they'll go with it. And if they're just little robots, they say, hey, wait a minute, we came here to hear a concerto number in E minor, you know, number 4, and you're supposed to play that for us because that's what our expectations are. And suddenly you went into something else. We don't even know what that music is. You know, and they'll get all flustered and upset like little robots. But the hip audience will say, hey, wait a minute, what's going on here? This is cool. I like this. This is engaging me more. I feel like this. We could shift, just make this shift like this. Wow. It's really scintillating. I feel inspiration here, you know. And so, this is what, you know, this is like be like that. Be a hip audience to your own spiritual practice. Be very hip to it. And when something occurs to you, say, hey, wait a minute, let me try this neither nor Pratt, like this. And you say, wow, that's really stunning. I didn't know I could apply it like that. Wow, this takes me in a whole, you know, this is greater depth, wow. And so the wow arises because you've gone deeper into the guts of it, you know. Like, and as upset as we are about Agenda 21, the technocracy, the dystopian technocracy, and their, you know, belief that this is our salvation, the Age of Aquarius, the New Age is our salvation, as upset as we are about that, we still have to practice in this neutral mode, because the truth is that we have been perceiving and believing and believing in belief and believing in perception and concepts and definitions as much as we would like to just junk it all. It's not really feasible. It's not a feasible ideal to have. Okay, that's over idealistic, and so it doesn't work. Okay, it's only theoretically possible. Pragmatically, you can say it's a virtual impossibility. We're not going to simply junk all of that instantly forever, from where we're at. It doesn't work that way. So we cannot really spend our time being overly critical about it, you know, and get into this attack mode. We cannot. This is not the way. We have to practice this neither nor. So I'm neither succeeding nor am I not succeeding. I'm neither, for instance, your health, say, I neither feel well nor do I not feel well. And if you're healed of something, say, I'm neither healed of this nor am I not healed of it. Try to lead off with the negative, because that makes us feel safer, all right? If you say, well, I'm both healed and not healed, that's also helpful, but I feel it may go quicker if we lead off with the negative. I'm neither healed nor am I not healed. So first we reassure the continuity fear. Say, hey, I'm neither healed. Continuity fear says, oh, great. And then we say, but neither am I not healed. And the continuity fear says, well, that's okay. I'll give you that one. I had a dream last night where I have this person in my dream just throughout my life, and they're always bossing me around and pushing me around and telling that they're right and all this. And last night this person came up to me, put his arm around me, and said, "Hey, you know what? I think I've screwed up. I've been mistaken. I'm wrong. I've been wrong." I said, it's like astonishing. I've never heard them ever say anything like that. You know, that they're always trying to be the boss, and they're right and I'm wrong. And they said, "Wow, I see my mistake now. I've been mistaken." And you know, I didn't say it. I just said, "Wow, that's great." You know. So there's a huge, huge change, you know, in inner psyche has just happened. So we cannot be condemnatory, because the way out is this neutrality practice. This is so, to help others, we cannot stand in judgment and condemnation of them. As much as sometimes we feel we'd like to, because we're so oppressed by this extraordinarily arrogant, you know, modern technology situation that is just bringing in so many fleas. You know, it's like a dog coming in with fleas. You know, you get this nice, beautiful looking dog, and you get it comes in and it's just loaded with fleas. And they keep saying, "But look at the nice, shiny dog. You know, look at the nice dog. Look at the friendly dog. A nice, friendly dog." Meanwhile, the fleas got this bubonic plague, you know, punchy princess plague. And, we're suffering so bad from it, and so we're irritated for sure. But this is the job of those who are here to help out with compassion, is don't, you know, allow that to gain the upper hand. Okay, we cannot allow that to gain the upper hand. It's practice that must gain the upper hand, which is why we have to be, just forgive ourselves for this continuity fear and keep working at it. So some total shift occurred in my psyche. I've had many, many breakthroughs recently, and I expect October to be, you know, to be the month of breakthroughs. It always is. Where this inner archetype admitted that they thought that they knew the right direction for my life, and I had to do what they said, and they were always criticizing me and getting angry and telling, you know, they said, I put their arm around me and said, "Hey, I've messed up. I've been wrong. I've been mistaken." It's just authority. It's authority figure. It's telling me that. You know, in other words, saying that you know, time to do what's right here. I see. You know, I've seen the error of my ways. I thought I was right, but I now see I wasn't right. You know, it takes a lot to admit that, doesn't it? And so you have to be willing to forgive them and accept their apology. And you know, you cannot just make such a situation where you have so much hatred they can never admit their mistake. You have to leave the door open for that. And they're seeing now, what the way you're doing it, neither nor. That's really the way I see that now. This is what's really where it's at. Yeah, you're right. And so the practice this morning was better than ever. Really extraordinary. We, you know, it was sort of like my whole psyche's aligned with this practice now. It's very important right now, as I've said, that we don't build up antagonism. That's why I say it's so important to have some great spiritual teachers in the world where we can go and sit with them. And I've always believed this will happen. And again, some want to sit in silence. I believe that likely to happen too. They just want to calm down their agitation, you know, because they realize this is getting in the way of their practicing. They're so angry at the way the world is going. We all are. You know, if you think about it, it's just easy to get infuriated. It's just astonishing, the arrogance at play. And yet, this hurts our success. So, you know, don't make it doubly worse. It's terrible, but then our reactions blind us to what really works. We don't want that at all. We don't want to be blinded. We want to see what works and then apply what works. Skillfully apply it, which means feedback from a very sober, clear mind, saying, okay, you know, can I expand this practice? Can I, you know, how can I? So I love practice. I love practice. It's never easy. It's never easy, is it? You have to really somehow get into it. It's the same as musical practice. You pick up the guitar and you feel rusty and you say, holy cow, I'm so clumsy. This is embarrassing. But maybe after an hour of warming up and you start playing better, and then you start hearing some good music and get inspired. Before you know it, after 3 or 4 hours have passed and you put in a really good practice session, you know, and you say, wow, I'm further along than before. But when you first pick up the guitar, you know, it's very rough. You just feel like, I don't really want to, do I have to do this? So the reward has to be worth it. You know, the hearing the good music has to be worth, you know, getting the rust off. It's just like you work out one day, you wake up in the morning, your body's all stiff, and oh, I got to go stretching again, and my back hurts, and all this stuff. Oh boy. But you know, if you want to do something well, you know, enough, you're gonna start, you know, limbering up, and you're gonna go through the necessary warm up period. So, same thing with spiritual practice. Same. It's not like everything's different if you start. No, it's hey, this is just like, you know, this other stuff, except I'm going in a different direction here. I'm learning a new skill. I'm acquiring this wonderful capability of actually evaporating continuity fear, which is the ability that we all need. Ultimately, this is the one ability we all need. So I was successful to a large extent this morning. I don't want to force myself to go back over it right at the moment, because there's a big wow around this. But we'll see what comes up here. I want to keep everyone motivated. I understand those who are saying they need some help with silence, and I hope that will come soon. We need great spiritual teachers to keep us positive, so we don't get overreactive to the nastiness that's going on in the world. It's so disappointing. You know, it's so disappointing. For many of us, it's just crushing disappointment. And yet, if we see that we can still practice effectively spiritually, then we realize, hey, I'm going to be liberated from this forever. Hey, that's pretty cool. So why should I get down? This is great. Great opportunity. I'm getting motivated, severely motivated. So this is a great time, because it's maximum motivation. We say, holy cow, look how terrible, dystopian these folks are. I don't want to have anything to do with that. No, thank you. So let me really get after it. So it's a great time to be motivated, actually. I don't mind it. Look at it that way. Glasses half full. How wonderful you have these idiots running the world. This means I really don't want to be part of this idea of a world at all. Anyone who believes there's a world is a total idiot. You know, really. So I don't want to be part of that. So let me really get into practice here. Now, the lack of spiritual teachers in the world that really have it, you know, really, you can say, wow, yeah. This isn't a big issue, a big problem. I'm trying to help solve that problem. What can we do? Each one of us try to fill the lack. There's a severe lack. So I'm saying, hey, we could use the help of everyone, all teachers. I've called on them before. I said, all teachers throughout, you know, all the teachers that there are, you know, come, please come on back here and help us out right now, because we don't want to get into aggravation. That's going to short circuit our path. It's going to cut us off from the path. We want to be very happy, very elated, not because this dystopian technocratic, you know, nightmare is something we want, but because we're getting free of it. That's why we're so happy. So I don't need this. Can you imagine for me how nice it would be? No more technology. Oh God, that would be so beautiful. I just have had a hideous time with technology, truly hideous. And you know, it's like working with some stubborn donkey that doesn't want to do what you want to do, and you know, it's just been horrible. But the less to think about, the better. You know, thank God the Holy Spirit is here with us, giving us spiritual practice that we see, hey, this is working. This is going to work. This is going to work. Now, I know getting into practice seems like the most difficult thing in the world. And it is, because you're not sure, will it really work? Should I really put my efforts there? Or where shall I put them, etc.? But it's the same thing like getting into a musical instrument. You know, who can say, somebody says, you know, I just really want to do this. Why? I want to hear beautiful music. That's why. And I know, if I feel if I put in the work, I'm going to hear beautiful music. Okay? It's like that. Well, maybe you say, I want to feel beautiful. I want to feel something that is truly, you know, I can't even put it into words. It's just perfection. I want to feel perfection right now. Well, then you put in the work on the spiritual path, because I want to feel perfection right now. So then you put in the work. This is what will bring us to that. Nothing else will bring it to that. Music won't bring that to us at all. We can feel perfection right here, right now, because that's where perfection is. There is nowhere else. The fact that we're pretending there's somewhere else to try to trick God doesn't mean that there is somewhere else. Not at all. So the key to this neither nor practice is you get better and better and better and better and better at it. Okay, so don't worry. You're not going to be a virtuoso as you start out. It doesn't work that way, of course. You don't pick up a guitar for the first time and you're not a virtuoso. You're not going to be a virtuoso at it, of course. And nobody expects you to be. But you develop, if you keep working at it, you get better and better and better and better and better. And it just has to be something that for you, this is your thing. You know, nobody can make it your thing. It's just some people decide, hey, I want to feel perfect right now. I don't want to wait for some future to feel perfect. I want to feel perfect right now. And ultimately, right now is the only way that you feel the perfection, because that's all there is. God did not create time. There's no such thing as time. Time is the attempt to scam God. That is the scam. It's invented, it's imagined, it's not real. Time, distance, process, and form is not real at all. It has no reality to it. It's just total whimsicality, absurdity. And yet, instead of putting it down, that doesn't work. That stirs up continuity fear. Instead of doing that, we do the neither nor practice, which takes a neutral position on everything. So as much as it might just irk us, we take a neutral position on technology. I neither accept technology nor do I reject. I neither accept technology nor do I not accept technology. I neither accept a future nor do I not accept a future. And you see but this is what works. This is what works, okay? This is what I believe this person in the dream, this archetypal figure in the dream, came up to me and put his arm around me and said, hey, I really screwed up. I've been mistaken. I mean, I haven't been right. I see my mistake. And they repented. This archetypal figure actually repented in the dream. This is extraordinary. How did this possibly come about? And so there's no more enmity there, you know, within me. There's no conflict. It's like, hey, we're now on the same page, you know. It came about because it's neither nor practice. I didn't attack anything. I simply took a neutral stance. I neither believe in the future, nor do I not believe in the future. I neither believe in time, nor do I not believe in time. I neither believe in healing, nor do I not believe in healing. I neither believe in truth, nor do I not believe in truth. Neutral across the board. And this ultimately is what opens the eye of truth, this arrogance that has been ruling us, bossing us. They say, hey, you know, I see now, you know. Somehow they recognize, somehow an inner recognition takes place. Because you're not trying to pin them into a corner, not attacking them, not confronting, not judging, not condemning. And the continuity of fear relaxes. And when the continuity fear relaxes, it enables some inner recognition to take place, which is archetypally revealed in the dream. I neither know nor do I not know. I neither know nor do I not know. So you just have to be creative. When anything comes to your mind, you say, hey, wait a minute, let me try a neither nor on that and see where it goes. Don't expect results. Let me just try it. It's like a musician. Let me try this little riff here, you know. Let me see how this sounds. You know, sometimes it sounds, it didn't sound so great, or it's a little difficult. Let me practice it, or do something. Says, hey, you know, I like how that sounds. It's the same thing with the neither nor practice. And you know, find yourself applying it to stuff you would never think of applying it to. And say, can I really apply it to that? Really? We've never thought of applying that. But those are the ones that are important to apply it to. You say, I can apply it to that too? You mean that's also, I can take a neutral stance on that too? Really? Wow. That's quite stunning, quite shocking. You say, what, we say, oh, that will never would have has occurred to me before. But it's the same with music, right? When you come up with something, you say, hey, wait, that never occurred to me to try playing that before. But now that I've tried it, hey, I like how that sounds. I like how that sounds. So there is, the thing about music is there's sort of this immediate feedback of discovery, of taking risks and discovery. So it's similar to the spiritual path in that way. In the spiritual path, there is pretty immediate feedback when you do something. It's like, wow, the feedback is, wow, I got away with it. I thought it was some taboo. I thought, I can't say that. I get, wow, wow. So there's also this very in the now feedback about it. So quite a lot of similarities. Now, some make the huge mistake of using spiritual practice and path only to make them greater musicians. That's the big mistake. Okay. That's not the goal. The goal is abundance. It's perfection right now. Perfection right now. But yeah, I mean, a lot of musicians use meditation, all sorts of spiritual practice, but their real aim is, I want to be the world's greatest musician. I want to make here great music, you know. Okay, no, that's not our goal here at all. We're not here to make music. We're here to experience the innate, inherent, natural self of perfection in the now. Perfection in the now. Absolute perfection in the now. All now is in the now. So the now is perfect. It's not fragmented. It's not fragmented. The now is not fragmented. But in our practicing, we would say the now is neither fragmented nor is it not fragmented. Or we say the now is neither, it's neither not fragmented nor is it fragmented. It's neither not fragmented nor is fragmented. Either way, the now is neither fragmented nor is it not fragmented. And take a neutral position on it. This is what ultimately produces this inner harmony, is you're not standing in condemnation of yourself. It's forgiveness. It's practical forgiveness of yourself. Because obviously we've been asserting for so long that it is fragmented. So to say it's not is attacking ourselves, is attacking a position that we've held with great hope for so long, you know, with great and hope and anticipation and love and creativity. And so to attack it, you know, it doesn't work that way. We have to say, look, it's neither fragmented nor is it not fragmented. Now is neither here now, nor is it not here now. All of the now is neither here now, nor is it all the now not here now. And this gives the one that was mistaken, our mistake in trying to scam God, it lets it save face and recognize the truth. Like, oh, I made a mistake, you know. Because we're not standing in condemnation. We're just practicing this neutrality. It's all good. It's all good. Let's honor our creativity. It's fine. It's fine. Well, you know, we made a mistake, and now we're honoring our creativity, evaporating the continuity fear, and everything will be fine. Again, I know this is super difficult for people, and there's no question about it, which is why we need great teachers now, to at least help us reduce our agitation. To some, you know, maybe the people are so agitated they can't even practice at all. You know, this is a possibility. So, Holy Spirit will get me tuned in, you know. We'll get tuned into what's effective help. It's possible to really give effective help once there is a true inner harmony, like within anyone, for example, within myself. You cannot be a teacher unless you've truly resolved, you know, truly resolved it. There's no way. It's not possible. You can't truly help others calm down if you haven't truly reached this harmonious accord within yourself. And yet the flip side is when you do, you can help. No doubt about it. Because others will feel that you've done it. You know, they will know, wow, You've done it. I don't know how you've done it, but you've done it. If they're honest, you know, they may say, well, if you can't tell me, then that means you haven't done it. You know, that's being dishonest, of course. That's being egoic. But if you're honest, which is you have to be honest on the path, get honest feedback, you'll have a feeling like, wow, I feel like someone, this one has truly, you know, has this inner, truly has inner harmony and peace. So they must have done it. So there must have been some way they did it. So I have to believe that, you know. And so, you know, let's work on getting it done. It can be done. It can be done. So let's calm down. Let's calm down. If we can be liberated, why do we need, if we can be liberated from the future and the past, why do we need to be so agitated? If liberation has already happened, which it has, why do we need to focus on agitation, really? You know, honestly. Why don't we just accept, wow, I can succeed, I will succeed, I've already succeeded. I can abide, I will abide, I'm already abiding, I'm already abiding. And breathe in that air, take a breath of that. Take a fresh, take another hit of that. You know, the quicksilver meshes are, take another hit of fresh air and California sunshine. Well, these are all the, you know, the pagan, well, humanists coming out here say, man, I just got to get that fresh air and sunshine and I'll be fine. Let me just breathe in, you know, we're breathing in the feeling that we are going to succeed. No question about it. In fact, we already have. We just need to accept this. Breathe. Take another hit of that. You know, all these people now in the world are spending their time taking hits off bongs. You know, okay, that's not where it's at. That's you know, upside down and backwards. Because again, that makes their bumbling efforts seem great to them. Like, wow, I really not practicing at all, but I feel fine about that. That, you know, is a black hole. That's going into a very, very dark black hole. I can tell you this for sure. This is the wrong way to go, and you'll regret it to the utmost. So we're taking a hit of, it's already, can, I can, I will, I already am abiding. A hit of, I'm already abiding. How cool is that? So the abidance that anyone has is really everyone's abidance, because it's just they realize that everyone is already abiding. We cannot leave what we are, but the Holy Spirit has already resolved all continuity fear. It's already done it, but we're just honoring time. So it seems like it takes some time to reach acceptance of this fact, but it's already happened. Take a hit of that. Take a hit of it's already happened, and see how you feel. Start taking a hit of spiritual practice. And you know what? You won't even, drugs will no longer turn your head, all this stuff. You just say, wow, what a waste of time that is. And of course you have regrets, and so you want to honor time, say, well, why did I spend my time that way? Well, continuity fear is why. This is all just a dance of continuity fear. We don't need to break it down into any more detail at all, because ultimately that's all it is. It's a forest of continuity fear trees, you know. Why do we need to examine each tree? It's just the same roots. The roots are all, it's all rooted in continuity fear, all of it. So all we need to do is evaporate that continuity fear, and poof, you know, the dark forest is gone. The deep, dark, scary forest is gone. I know ego freaks will say, that's terrible symbology, but if you've ever been in a really nasty, deep, dark forest, you know, you want to get out of there. Right? Unless you're kind of cuckoo. You know, forest of fear. What we're talking about is forest of fear, you know, a forest of fear. Continuity fear gives rise to all these forms of fear, and we certainly want to get out of that forest. But the way to do it is to say, hey, it's okay for me to just to leave the forest and just view it as one forest. That's all. I just left this forest. That's it. I don't need to have relationships with all the trees and try to figure out all the different trees. No, it's just dance of continuity fear. It doesn't matter how it dances. It makes no difference. It's just evaporate the continuity fear, the dance will be gone. That's just all there is to it. We're in charge. We have the power. You see, spiritual practice reminds us that we have the power. We're the sovereigns here. We don't need to let continuity fear dictate to us, you know, what we're supposed to do. Let the Holy Spirit tell us what we're supposed to do here, okay? So, perfection right now. All of now is right here now. Right here, right now. All of now is right here, right now. It's not in time, but we'll say all of now is neither in time nor is it not in time. All of now is neither in time nor is it not in time. All of now is neither in time nor is it not in time. Okay, this is the genius of the practice. We know abstractly it's not in time, but our continuity fear and our creativity is so enmeshed in trying to make it seem like it's in time that we need to acknowledge this, okay? So we'll take a neutral stance. And again, I've said the continuity fear, all the forms of continuity fear, I call it the land of long faces, the realm of long, land of long faces. They accepted this. They accepted this. I started out the neither nor practice. I had that dream where I've been held hostage for so long by these maniacs in the land of long faces of mental derangement and sadness and suffering. And they finally set me free. As a hostage says, you're free to go. And they were good, true to their word. That's exactly what happened. And so this is why I feel this practice is going to work for us. Extraordinary long-term enmities are resolving in my dreams and my awareness now through this, because we're acknowledging our great effort to scam God. I mean, we put all our hope and effort and creativity and love and care into this, trying to create a scenario to trick God. So, you know, we need to acknowledge this. Absolutely we do. And I promised him I would. I promised all these trees of continuity fear that you know, I'm not going to attack them or, you know, or condemn them. I'm going to say, hey, look, you know, I'll do the neither nor practice. And they realized something deep down. They said, okay, this is agreeable to us. Even on all their insanity, they could still feel that this will work, and they accepted it, you know, and set me free. It set me free. Because we're being held hostage by our continuity fear. There's no doubt about that, okay? We don't need to psychologize anybody in the world. It's very simple. We're all being held hostage by our continuity fear. And we need to make this deal so we can be set free. This continuity fear will set us free because we promise to do this practice and acknowledge our efforts, even though they're efforts to try to deceive God and deceive ourselves, because we're an extension of God. We've been trying to deceive ourselves too. Keep that in mind. And yet, instead of condemning ourselves, we take this neutral approach. I neither accept it nor do I reject it. I neither reject it nor do I not reject it. I neither condemn myself nor do I not condemn myself. So we're not being dishonest here. We're saying, yeah, I really don't like it, but I really like the effort I put into it. You see? It's both. So we acknowledge both sides of this issue. Right? I neither condemn myself nor do I not condemn myself. I neither condemn myself nor do I not condemn myself. And this satisfies both sides of the issue. Each get what they want. And they can walk together then, you see. You can walk together. Your inner self aligns. Everything aligns within you. And now you're on the same page and you're walking together. And they're no longer suffering all this conflict and torment and all this stuff that we've been suffering for so long, and it's so hideous. You know, this is why I keep working at this so intensely. I know how hideous it is. It gets it. Absolutely, I know. So much so that you don't even want to look back at all. You know, I just don't even want to reflect back at all. It's been too horrible. Too horrible. Absolutely. So an inner peace is possible, an inner accord is possible, even while we're here in the world. We don't need to reject the world. I neither accept the world, nor do I not accept it. I neither reject the world, nor do I not reject it. I neither reject the world, nor do I not reject. I neither reject the future, nor do I not reject the future. I neither reject the future and past, nor do I not reject the future and past. I neither accept the future and past, nor do I not accept the future and past. And, you know, and say it like you mean it. You really mean it. You're sincere. Say it with practice with sincerity. Not just rote practice, mumbling, okay, someone told me to say this, I'm mumbling. No, practice with sincerity. You really mean it. You're truly committed to this. I neither reject the future, nor do I not reject the future. I neither accept the plan to scam God, nor do I not accept the plan to scam God. I neither reject the plan to scam God, nor do I not reject the plan to scam God. So at first I say, I neither reject it, so our continuity first says, oh, great. And then I say, but neither, nor do I not reject it, nor am I not rejecting it means, it's a double negative, isn't it? So I'm not ruling out not rejecting it. I'm not taking the stance where I'm not going to reject it. I say, nor do I not reject it. So I'm not saying that I'm not going to reject it. I'm not saying I'm rejecting it, nor am I saying I'm not rejecting it. And this is a very gentle way of practicing. You see, it calms the continuity fear down, evaporates the edge to it, you know. It likes what it hears. It likes what it hears, but it understands, you know, that you're saying neither nor. You're not taking a stance, but it calms it down. It calms it down. So, if you have an infirmity like my back, I say, well, my back is neither. I neither accept healing for my back, nor do I not accept healing for my back. I neither accept wellness, nor do I not accept wellness. I neither accept perfection, nor do I not accept perfection. Or we can say, I neither reject perfection, nor do I not reject perfection. But to help the continuity, if you're the most, you might say, I neither accept perfection, and it goes, oh, great. And nor do I not accept perfection. And it's so calmed by what we first said, I neither accept rejection, that it kind of just says, okay, you know, you can say, nor do I not accept perfection. It'll let that through. But if you say, I neither reject perfection, they'll say, hey, wait a minute, you're not rejecting perfection. So start out with the negative, say, I neither accept perfection. It calms the continuity fear, and then neither do I not accept perfection. Then it'll say, well, it's okay, because it's feeling less fearful. Less defensive. Because we do feel so ashamed of using our creativity in this way. It's like we want to blame creativity for it. Say, oh, it's creativity's fault. But then if we stand in blame of our creativity, how are we going to feel safe about reality, you see? This is the problem, isn't it? If we condemn our own creativity, then we're condemning ourselves to non-functionality, right? We need our creativity to function. So we cannot condemn our creativity. We must acknowledge it's not the fault of our creativity. It's the fault. It's simply our own whimsical choice of trying to, you know, be greater than God. It's not the blame of our creativity. But nor are we thrilled with our experiencing, right? Not at all. So we acknowledge both. Like, you know, I really hated this trip. It's been a terrible thing. creativity, you really presented a very terrible scenario, but of course I asked you to. So I'm not thrilled by that, and I need to acknowledge that, but I'm also acknowledging that I'm not rejecting, you know, the creativity that was involved in that. I'm not rejecting my creativity. So I neither accept perfection, nor do I reject perfection. Or I neither accept perfection, nor do I not accept perfection. That makes it even easier for continuity fear. I neither accept perfection, nor do I not accept perfection. And this terrible inner struggle we have is be over this. We're trying to blame. But what we're doing here is we're just taking a neutral stance. I'm neither blaming, nor am I not blaming. I'm neither accessing blame, nor am I not assessing blame. So we're not saying that we're not upset, okay? We are. But we're expressing in a way that resolves the whole thing, the bigger picture. So I'm neither assessing blame, nor am I not assessing blame. And this feels like there's this inner accord, okay, say, okay, you know, let's put this whole thing behind us. Because we have to go forward arm in arm with our creativity, right? Our mind, our creativity, all this. So this inner accord has to come. And instead of the mind trying to boss us through continuity fear, our intimidate itself, split itself and intimidate itself, and you know it now says, hey, okay, let's walk together here now. Again, we don't have to psychologize the world anymore. We don't have to judge the world. We don't have to think, what are they doing? No, it's just a forest of continuity trees. You know, it's a big forest of continuity fear. It's a jungle of continuity fear. I don't need to go in the jungle. There's nothing to learn in the jungle. I already know all there is to know is that it's just a jungle of continuity fear, and right spiritual practice will evaporate this continuity fear, and we can come to this harmonious accord and abide. And abidance then will take place. So that's all we need to know. Don't need to know anything else. It's only our continuity fear says all this other stuff we have to know. There's just delaying tactics. That's all it is, just delaying tactics. When the continuity fear finally, there's an inner accord, then it says, now, we don't need to focus on any other stuff. Let's just, and when that happens, you know, full stop in the now. Full stop on the wow leads to full stop in the now. So when we say, well, I'm neither full stopped in the now, nor am I not full stopped in the now. So to practice easing our way into it, we need to again keep this accord going. I'm neither full stopped in the now, nor am I not full stopped in the now. So instead of trying to force your way into the now, it's way better, in my opinion, to practice this way. I'm neither full stopped in the now, nor am I not full stopped in the now. So we start out with reassuring the continuity fears. Try to make your practice, the first part reassures your continuity fear. I'm neither full stopped in the now, and it says, oh, great, nor am I not full stopped in the now. Then it says, well, okay, we have a deal. And of course, neutrality is open-minded, saying I don't know, which allows us then to experience what actually inherently is, which is the now. The now is full stopped in the now. That's the nature of now, is that it is full stopped in the now, because there's nowhere else to be. So it's like effortlessly full stopped in the now. And we can just say like, wow, this now is really, is neither full stopped in now, nor is it not full stopped in the now. This now is neither full stop in the now, nor is it not full stop in the now. So let that be the expression. The feeling can be one thing. The expression can be this neutrality to keep this inner accord, you know, and keep honoring our efforts that we made to scam God. It was been a great effort on our part. Full of massive creativity. So even though we're now feeling the now, we say, well, I'm neither full stop in the now, nor am I not full stopped in the now, as an expression of it. And that's fair enough, isn't it? That's fair enough. As long as we're feeling it, why do we care how it's just conceptually, verbally expressed? I mean, how is that detracting from our experiencing of it? If it doesn't detract, then all is good. All is good. You know, it's being repentant. Instead of an arrogant attitude, it's being repentant. And we do have to, repentance is what works. Arrogance will never work. Arrogance says, no, I got to get rid of that, ego, so I'm going to kill that ego, so terrible. No, we don't do that. We acknowledge, give it equal billing acknowledgement that this represents a massive, massive effort on our part of supreme creativity, you know, to try and fool God. And this is, you know, this is part of, this is, you know, part of what we are, is being supremely creative like this and adventurous. So we cannot reject it. We gratefully acknowledge it, you know, but also we acknowledge that it wasn't any fun, and we want to set it down, right? It was terrible. It's fearful. We don't like fear. So I neither accept full stop in the wow, nor do I reject full stop in the wow. I neither accept full stop in the wow, nor do I not accept full stop in the wow. I neither accept full stop in the wow, nor do I not accept full stop in the wow. Now, I would surmise that anyone who is truly abiding would speak in this way to show others this is how you need to practice. And they wouldn't take this attitude of like, no, a real teacher who's abiding will never speak this way. They'd only speak of the oneness of it. No, I don't believe that that's true at all. They because they know this is not affecting how they feel their abidance, and it's what's enabling their abidance in the first place. So why would they not, you know, speak this way? Ananda Mahima, for instance, did speak this way, very much so. No one could ever pin her down. It's like, well, what do you? Well, I'm neither. You know, it's neither this nor is it not this. It's what? It is trying to show practice. This, you know, practice. He's not trying to say, hey, yeah, I'm enlightened, so I'm going to say, yes, I am in full abidance, and this is where it's at. Because that puts polarity into the continuity fear feels polarized over this. You see, the inner doesn't bring about the inner accord. So we do need to have this neutral expression to if we want to help others, to show them what they need to do. And arrogance doesn't like that. Arrogance says, no, I want to win. I got to defeat somebody. Someone's got to be defeated here. Now, no one needs to be defeated. Nothing needs to be defeated or destroyed, or attacked or condemned or judged or anything like that. But we can say, well, I neither judge nor do I not judge. I neither condemn nor do I not condemn. I neither attack nor do I not attack. I neither accept nor do I not accept. Now, practice like this, because again, we have to also accommodate the fact that we, you know, really do want to move on from this, right? So we don't take an absolute position either way, and this enables the absolute position that always is to be experienced. It's not like we need to establish an absolute position. God established that from the beginning. So that's always there. We don't need to establish it. We don't need to affirm it to make sure that it, you know, doesn't dissipate or something. No, it cannot dissipate. It cannot be weakened. Nothing can happen to it. So there's no reason that we need to stand and arrogantly say, well, I have to say that I'm for this, otherwise it won't exist. This is not true. This is not true at all. So I neither accept full stop in the now, nor do I reject. I neither accept full stop in the now, nor do I not accept full stop in the now. Now, arrogance will say, well, why don't you do it this way? Why don't you do it this way? Well, the purpose of a good teacher is they've worked through all this arrogance and they see, well, you know, this is probably the best way to do it and advise do it this because it brings about... arrogance will say, well, why don't you say, I neither accept full stop the now, nor do I reject full stop in the now. Well, you could do it that way. But it seems to me it's better to say, I neither accept full stop in the now, nor do I not accept full stop in the now. It's a gentler way, you know, less arrogance involved in this. Less belief that you need to defeat something or someone needs to be made out to be the bad guy, the scapegoat, the bad guy in all of this. You know, we don't need to find a bad guy in all of this, actually. It's just our own whimsicality and that resulted in continuity fear. We just wanted to pretend and we didn't realize this would result in this severe continuity fear. So, you know, we've been burned by it and, you know, lesson learned. I neither accept continuity fear, nor do I not accept continuity fear. You can even practice that way. Yeah, I'm neither accepting of continuity fear, nor am I not accepting of it. Or we could say, I neither reject continuity fear, which relaxes our, you know, relaxes our continuity fear. Says, oh great, I neither reject continuity fear, nor do I not reject continuity fear. So you see how you kind of play with it, like say, okay, do it this way, and it feels like this, which is nice, but if I try it this way, maybe it's a little better. This is the, you know, musical spirituality says, let me try this way, and say, well, they're all pretty good, but I think this one here is probably, you know, a little bit superior to the other one, so. I neither reject continuity fear, nor do I not reject continuity fear. I neither reject continuity fear, nor do I not reject continuity fear. break, to sort of rest in the wow here. It's like the fear of continuity, the continuity fear forest has all these loudspeakers attached to all the trees, and they have this seductive music, Xanadu, playing throughout the forest, you know. So you think, yeah, we gotta believe in magic. Nothing will stand in our way. Wow. So they stay in the forest, believing in magic. A magical solution saying that, hey, there is no continuity fear because the scam worked. We don't have to go back to reality. We get to stay in this fearful forest. Don't have to leave it. What continuity fear? Except the only problem is we can't stand the fear and the inner conflict. So we want to leave. And then they say, no, I must listen to the siren song. I must stay in the forest of continuity fear. And then they get all conflicted and then project the conflict and blame someone else. Somebody else is trying to get me out of here, pull me out of here. I don't really want to leave here. You know, as if they don't have any motivation to leave. And this is the trouble. You know, we project and blame, project blame. What a beautiful day. The morning cloud cover is burning off. It's about noon, I think. It's like 1 o'clock. Holy cow, late burn off today. Very cool, late burn off. It's a very cool day, but nice. Well, we need the results, but what we say is, I neither accept results, nor do I not accept results. Okay, this is the discipline. You see, we're under this tremendous pressure for results, right? For, you know, full stop in the now. And full stop in the now. That is, full stopped in the now. Full stop in the full stop now. But instead of just saying, yeah, I gotta get results, start practicing and say, I neither accept any results, nor do I not accept any results. And really say that honestly, sincerely, and feel it when you say it, and then you feel something like, wow. I never even considered saying anything like that before in my life, and believing in it. I never even considered believing in something like this. I neither accept any results, nor do I not accept any results. So when results come, we can just keep saying, well, I neither accept any results. I'm either accepting of any results, nor am I not accepting of any results. So at the level of the dream, we're neutral. And this enables us then to experience, to feel, you know, what is intrinsically true and not the dream. We're able to feel it. Experience it. We can say, I neither accept healing, nor do I not accept healing. So instead of begging for healing, you know, this is a paradigm shift, isn't it? And we need it, this paradigm shift, because the paradigm shift in the world is taking place, and you may not like it at all. Okay, it's a paradigm shift. Instead of praying to God and saying, God, please heal me, I feel so terrible. I'll be good, but just please heal me. We don't do that anymore. Okay, this is not a wise way to approach it. Instead, say, I neither accept any healing, nor do I not accept any healing. I neither accept any healing, nor do I not accept any healing. I neither accept a perfectly functioning body, nor do I not accept a perfectly functioning body. Practice like this. Practice like this. This will enable us. And we can practice that. Say, this will neither enable us nor will it not enable us. This will enable us to abide in the now. Full stop in the now. And we say, this will neither enable us to full stop in the now, nor will it not enable us to full stop in the now. Say, this will neither enable us to full stop in the now, nor will it not enable us to full stop in the now. And again, we've reached some layer of belief that we didn't know we could ever possibly reach, right? I mean, people are spending all their time involved in all these role-playing scenarios and such. They never even consider this sort of spiritual practice. They keep thinking it's all about attack and conflict and drama and, you know, you betrayed me, or, oh, my true love, who will never betray me. Oh, but you betrayed me, and where can I find, you know, a new love, and you know, all the drama, emotional drama, everything that's going on in the world. Never does it arise within that dance, you know, what we're doing here. It doesn't even appear as a vague possibility, really. Not even a vague possibility. So how can you focus on it when you're in that dance of drama, the dance of the continuity fear? How can you possibly, you know, bootstrap yourself out of it, pull yourself up by the bootstraps? Because it's not even a vague consideration. So you're looking at people who are into the you know, the modern world and going forward with all this. You know, they're so busy, looking here, looking. It never even remotely occurs to them that they could possibly believe like this that we're doing. So how do you expect them to get out of it? You know, how will we expect them to get out of it? It's, you know, it's this is the situation. One has to hear from the teachers, the great spiritual teachers, and the way that they talk and believe is so different. They introduce a different way of believing, like, hey, we can actually do this. I neither believe in results, nor do I not believe in results. I neither believe I can be free, nor do I not believe I can be free. You know, to say this with sincerity, honoring both sides of this, like this, never occurs to anybody, does it? Comes from the Holy Spirit. We have to listen to the Holy Spirit and those who reflect the Holy Spirit's advice, the great teachers. Otherwise, you know, we won't even catch a faint whiff of it. It'll never occur to us. Continuity fear blinds us to this. And yet the blind leading the blind. United Nations, very blind, leading the blind. The eco-religionists, eco-humanists. And not that we're condemning, we're just pointing out that it never occurs to them to practice this way, right? It doesn't. So how can we expect them to be truly liberated at all? Of course we can't expect that. So we say, I'm neither accepting abidance in the now, nor am I not accepting abidance in the now. See, the polarity game can't think outside of polarity. You know, good against evil, light against dark. It cannot imagine anything outside of the polarity. So to take this neutral stance, it never occurs to them to do this. It never occurs to them. It feels very frightening, like, you know, this causes madness. You know, my polarity game will get all screwed up. I won't know who to attack, who to cling to, and what special relationships to have, and who to attack, and how to defend that. I don't know. Well, this is not a polarity game. What we say, and we practice it. Well, this is neither a polarity game, nor is it not a polarity game. I neither accept abidance in the now, nor do I not accept abidance in the now. It's a different game. It's a neutrality game. I neither accept results, nor do I not accept results. I neither accept my freedom, nor do I not accept my freedom. I neither accept truth, nor do I not accept truth. See, the polarity game test, you can't play that way. You gotta have one triumph over the other. Well, someone's darkness is trying to attack you and bring you down. You must destroy darkness. You know, this is the polarity game. And we say, I neither accept the polarity, I neither reject the polarity game, nor do I not reject the polarity game. In other words, whatever is said, you turn it into this neutrality game. You flip the script on it. So even though polarity is saying, you can't do this, we say, I neither reject that I can't do this, nor do I not reject that I can't do this. I neither accept that I cannot do this. I neither accept that I can do this, nor do I not accept that I can do this. I neither accept that this is possible, nor do I not accept that this is possible. I neither accept that this is possible, nor do I not accept that this is possible. You see how this compassionately evaporates the continuity fear and is developing. It brings about this inner accord, like, wow, I'm not in conflict with myself anymore. I'm not playing this polarity game anymore. Because I'm even with the polarity game, I'm seeing I'm not rejecting the polarity game, nor am I not rejecting the polarity game. Wow, you know. There's something within you says, wow, thank God, this is great. You know, I never considered doing this, you know, in my life. I never even faintly thought about this sort of practice. It's the Holy Spirit that brought it to my attention. And one morning I asked the Holy Spirit, please, you know, I'm really open to any practice you have. He said, try this. I heard this. Said, try neither nor. Try this practice like this. I just felt like, you know, give this a try. I said, wow, this seems very new. I don't know. I've never heard of such a thing. So we really don't, you know, as long as we're listening just to the continuity fear, we'll stay blind, and stay in the polarity game one way or the other. So I'm neither leaving the polarity game, nor am I not leaving the polarity game. See, try that. I'm neither leaving the polarity game, nor am I not leaving the polarity game. So you see, it's like a musician working on some song or trying to get some riffs that they can put together as a song. They try all sorts of stuff. So we keep flipping the script and thinking, what comes to mind? What can I practice on? Let me keep coming up with some way to practice on this. So I'm neither quitting the polarity game, nor am I not quitting the polarity game. I'm neither rejecting the future, nor am I not rejecting the future. I'm neither rejecting technology, nor am I not rejecting technology. I'm neither rejecting this trying to scam God, nor am I not rejecting trying to scam God. I'm neither rejecting perception, nor am I not rejecting perception. I'm neither rejecting belief, nor am I not rejecting belief. And then we can go on the other side. I'm neither accepting freedom, nor am I not accepting freedom. So the stuff the continuity fear wants to hang on to, reassure it, say, I'm neither rejecting it And then, nor am I not rejecting it. And the stuff the economy fears a little scared of, like freedom, we say, I'm neither accepting it, nor am I not accepting it. So this is the basic form of the practice. So I'm neither accepting the now, nor am I not accepting the now. You see? And we can say, I'm neither rejecting the polarity game, nor am I not rejecting the polarity game. See, the polarity game is what the continuity fear feels safe with. So we reassure it. I'm neither rejecting the continuity fear game, polarity game, nor am I not rejecting the continuity fear game. And something like freedom is what would scare continuity fear. So we say, I'm neither accepting freedom, nor am I not accepting freedom. So we've pretty much have ironed out here this practice, right? The basics of it. It's like a musician figuring out how to transpose everything. You know, they finally figure out, you know, I can just transpose into any key, you know, like that. Once they get it. You know, they do it to get in a singer's voice of the singer. They're playing for a singer. They need to transpose it to a key, what you know, that sounds good for the singer. It's a piece of cake. If they, you know, once they get it. So, I neither accept peace of mind, nor do I not accept peace of mind. I neither accept healing, nor do I not accept healing. I neither accept perfection, nor do I not accept perfection. And then, I neither reject fear, nor do I not reject fear. I neither reject confusion, nor do I not reject confusion. I neither reject defensiveness, nor do I not reject defensiveness. I neither, you know, reject vulnerability, nor do I not reject vulnerability. I neither reject vulnerability, nor do I not reject vulnerability. And to go the other side, I neither accept invulnerability, nor do I not accept invulnerability. I neither accept eternal life, nor do I not accept eternal life. I neither accept the isness, nor do I not accept the isness. I neither accept the isness, nor do I not accept the isness. I neither accept the now, nor do I not accept the now. So this teaching is something very different than what people orthodoxly expect. But keep in mind that what they orthodoxly expect has been fashioned by the continuity fear to be overly idealistic and therefore fail. That's so much failure on the spiritual path throughout history, over idealizing it, not truly forgiving oneself with compassion, and this has given rise to the eco-religionists who claim that no, the whole problem is, you know, you don't love your mother enough. Maybe she doesn't love you enough. It's an Oedipal, reverse Oedipal complex. Oh, the problem is the Mother Earth doesn't love us enough. Why doesn't she love us enough? Or we don't love her enough. She's so wonderful, but if we just loved her, everything would be fine. But of course, we're not rejecting Mother Earth. We neither reject not Mother Earth, nor do we not reject Mother Earth. We neither reject form, nor do we not reject form. We neither reject process, nor do we not reject process. We neither accept the one spiritual family, nor do we not accept the one spiritual family. We neither accept our perfect standing with God, nor do we not accept our perfect standing with God. Wow, how's that possible? Time has just flown by here. This is extraordinary. This is what you experience. Like, same with practicing music. If you really get into it, suddenly you look up, a couple hours have gone by, and you say, I lost track of time. I don't even know if it's 10 minutes, 5 minutes, however long. I have no idea. I wasn't thinking about time. Very similar situation to spiritual practicing here. Be a spiritual musician, as I always said. Be a spiritual musician. Doesn't mean play cool, lovey-dovey, let's all be one songs. That's not what I mean. Being a spiritual musician means practice spiritually, the way you used to practice as a musician. Yeah, you don't need to be a troubadour going around singing New Age songs. Okay, that's not necessary. Mother Earth, we're so sorry. We know you're our true creator. You created us. You built us up from the dust. And you're going to make us happy dust. You're going to sprinkle happy dust in our eyes. And we're going to be so happy here, living here with the mountains and the forests and the rivers. And we're going to, we're going to really love it here forever and ever and ever. And we'll be happy to lay ourselves down in death and decompose in your wonderful earth. And we don't need to be being a troubadour for Mother Earth. But we're neither rejecting being a troubadour for Mother Earth, nor are we not rejecting being a troubadour for Mother Earth. Yes, Mother Earth, I'm so happy you made me with breath that can be taken away at any instant, should you want to, and I'm okay with that, that my life can be sacrificed at any instant. What a wonderful creation to feel totally vulnerable at every moment. But it's okay. We know that when we die, we will return to your wonderful wonderfulness. I learned to love vulnerability by Mother Earth. But we're neither rejecting vulnerability, nor are we not rejecting vulnerability. Neither rejecting vulnerability, nor are we not rejecting vulnerability. Yes, Mother Earth, I'm so happy you gave me this little tiny wisp of a life. And after that, gone forever. But if I hadn't had this little wisp of life, how could I be grateful to you? So I'm so grateful for this little wisp of a life that will soon be, taken away from me. But I'm grateful anyway. At least I got to experience misery for a little while. I got to experience you, Mother Earth, and how the heat and the cold and the ultraviolet radiation and the cataracts and the indigestion and food poisoning and sleepless nights and achiness and irritations of all kinds. At least I got to experience all that. You know, I feel very fortunate. So, yeah, we're not going to reject our suffering. I neither reject all my suffering, nor do I not reject all my suffering. I neither reject my misery, nor do I not reject my misery. I neither reject misery, nor do I not reject misery. I neither reject impermanence, nor do I not reject impermanence. I probably hurt my back playing golf just so I could spend more time practicing like this. Absolutely. Yeah. But when it's ready, it'll get better. So I neither ask for miracles, nor do I not ask for miracles. I neither accept miracles, nor do I not accept miracles. I neither pray for miracles, nor do I not pray for miracles. I neither accept miracles, nor do I not accept miracles. I neither trust in the Holy Spirit, nor do I not trust in the Holy Spirit. I neither trust in the Holy Spirit, nor do I not trust in the Holy Spirit. So, see, we don't have to say, hey, Holy Spirit, I trust in you. The Holy Spirit already trusts in us completely, you see. So we don't have to establish trust there. We just have to get this inner accord of you know, the continuity fear dropping its all its objections, you know, and saying, okay, you know, let's back off this whole thing together. So, you know, if we say, oh yes, Holy Spirit, I totally trust you, I'm going to trust you, I'm going to trust you. Continuity fear is like, whoa. So it's better to say, hey, I neither trust the Holy Spirit, nor do I not trust the Holy Spirit. The continuity will say, okay, that's fair enough. That's fair. At least you've acknowledged my fear of that. And gave it equal billing here. So that's okay. So if you give both truth and lies equal billing, what is going to win out? The truth. What is will win out. If you give what is and what isn't equal billing, what is going to be experienced? What is, of course. So give equal billing to it. It's okay. I neither trust the Holy Spirit, nor do I not trust the Holy Spirit. I neither trust God, nor do I not trust God. I neither love God, nor do I not love God. I neither love my freedom, nor do I not love my freedom. I neither accept the guidance of the Holy Spirit, nor do I not accept the guidance of the Holy Spirit. I neither accept truth, nor do I not accept truth. So this way of practicing is very advanced because it presupposes, you know, that we have already repented and are very much far along in repentance. Otherwise, the arrogance will get in the way. That's why Jesus didn't start out with this kind of teaching 2,000 years ago, nor in the Course in Miracles. He's pointing towards it, but, you know, first the arrogance has to die down, which is just continuity fear right now at this point. Just continuity fear needs to die down gradually. And not feel like it's under attack. Of course, it knows that if we attack it, it keeps it. So it encourages us to attack it, actually. This is the funny part about it. Our continuity fear is very clever. It'll encourage us to try and destroy the ego, knowing that this will actually cause the continuity fear to get even stronger. Won't work. So if you start out helping others, first you have to start from where they're at. And you have to, you know, advise them, well, you know, let's work on getting rid of the ego here. Let's work on getting rid of the ego. And as you do that, you gradually become more adept at practicing and evaluating your practice and being aware and feedback. And you develop momentum and but ultimately, you know, trying to get rid of the ego ultimately is not what ultimately succeeds at all. I neither reject the ego, nor do I not reject the ego. I neither reject the ego, nor do I not reject the ego. I neither accept spirit, nor do I not accept spirit. I've neither given up attack, nor have I not given up attack. I've neither given up attack, nor have I not given up attack. Now, this might seem blasphemous, you know, to those who are on the path of trying to triumph and trying to win and trying to overcome. And, but we don't overcome ourselves or anything. We have an accord and an agreement to gently, you know, gently allow and gently feel what is. We don't need to do anything for what is to be what is. Nothing has to be overcome. What is always what is. There's no triumph or victories or nothing we need to do to for what is to be what it is. There's nothing we need to do. So practicing neutrality is good enough. It's good enough. That's how it works. Don't make assertions one way or the other, ultimately. But yet we do make assertions both ways in a gentle way. So I neither accept truth, nor do I not accept truth. Those are two assertions in the one coin of neutral definition, neutral reaction, neutral assertion here. And our overall psyche can accept this. This is like food. So it tastes like food. Seems like it has food there. There's nothing really to digest. But it, you know, it seems like there's structure, form, all that stuff that we're used to. Even though the meta message is neutral, therefore what is what we will experience. We don't have to establish what is. Not in any way do we need to establish what is. Therefore, the efforts based on that, you know, are just going to frighten us, actually, thinking that somehow we need, that what is somehow determined by us, by our efforts. No. But I'm neither giving up efforts to establish what is, nor am I not giving up efforts to establish what is. So reassure yourself, your continuity fear. Hey, continuity fear, I'm neither giving up efforts to establish what is, nor am I not giving up efforts to establish what is. We say, hey, continuity fear, I'm neither giving up efforts to establish what is, and we say, hey, Spirit, Holy Spirit, nor am I not giving up efforts to establish what is. So the continuity fear says, okay, I'm good, I'm relaxed now, and the Holy Spirit says, okay, that's great. Then, from this neutrality, what is can more easily dawn upon us. Continuity fear is not in some real hostile, rejecting mode. If it is, it will stop you cold with so many, many defenses and tricks. I'm neither rejecting the continuity fear's tricks and defenses, nor am I not rejecting the continuity fear's tricks and defenses. I say this, honestly and sincerely, I'm neither rejecting all the continuity fear's tricks and defenses, nor am I not rejecting all the continuity fear's tricks and defenses. And if we go into abiding, we'll say, I'm neither accepting this abidance, nor am I not accepting this abidance. I'm neither accepting this abidance, nor am I not accepting this abidance. Just take it like that. So, to the question that I had several years ago, I went into a state of abidance once when I woke up early in the morning and a couple times while driving. And I was like, wow, this is it. It's so easy. You know, I was like, well, didn't know how to express it, what to say. I was just, you know, a bug eyed. Like, this is wonderful. Wow, this is so easy. This is not so difficult. Wow. And I want to stay in this, but how do I stay in it? You know, instead of that, just right away we'd say, hey, I'm neither accepting this state of abidance. I'm neither accepting this abidance. I'm neither accepting abidance, nor am I not accepting abidance. I'm neither accepting abidance, nor am I not accepting abidance. Just stay cool and calm and just practice like this. It's like stepping into the, you know, the Paris Grand Opera House. You know, it's just like unbelievably gilded and baroque and gilded and she and everything else. And it's like, wow, what is this? Instead, you say, okay, I'm here. Okay, but what's important? Oh, my opera glasses. And let me clean them. So you get a little rag out and you're cleaning your opera glasses and making sure they're working. You're not focusing on, you know, wow, I'm here. Oh my gosh, this is overwhelming. Nice, yeah. Okay, I'm looking at my opera glasses, you know, my ticket, where my seat, get in my seat, clean my opera glasses again, you know, straighten out my outfit, you know, and relax in the seat, look at the program, you know. And meanwhile, gradually, subliminally, you're kind of taking in the whole scene, right, and gradually getting used to it. You know, don't let it hit you all at once and just a complete overwhelm, be overwhelmed by it. So just say, oh, abidance. Okay, well, I'm either accepting this abidance nor am I not accepting this abidance. Oh, I feel the perfection. I'm neither accepting this perfection nor am I not accepting this perfection. I neither accept this oneness nor do I not accept this oneness. I neither accept this perfect standing of all in the one family of spirit nor am I not accepting the perfect standing of all in the one family of the spirit. I neither accept this elation nor do I not accept this elation. I neither accept this bliss nor do I not accept this bliss. I neither accept this peace nor do I not accept this peace. And, just stay in the now of practicing here. I'm neither accepting these results, nor am I not accepting these results. I'm neither accepting this, you know, this tremendous breakthrough, nor am I not accepting this tremendous breakthrough. Just try to stay neutral like this. Practice this neutrality. Practice the neutrality. Of course, you're experiencing it, so you're not, what you're feeling is not neutral. But from the standpoint of perception, belief, and continuity fear, what you're saying, I'm staying neutral with this. You know, I'm as far as expressing it like this, I'm neither accepting this experience nor am I not accepting this experience. I neither want this to continue nor do I not want it to continue. I neither want this to continue, nor do I not want this to continue. I neither accept the wow of this, nor do I not accept the wow of this. I neither accept this breakthrough, nor do I not accept this breakthrough. And then you'll take a deep breath, take another hit of this wonderful practice. I neither accept instant healing, nor do I not accept instant healing. I neither accept instant wellness, nor do I not accept instant wellness. I neither accept freedom from all suffering, nor do I not accept freedom from all suffering. Now stay very, you know, practice-oriented. And then let the chips fall where they may. You know, wherever the chips fall, they fall. Don't be into results so much, right? It's a funny thing. By not being into results, the results are there because there's an inherency to our being, complete inherency to it all, right now. So we don't really have to be into results. We just need to be into neutrality, practicing neutrality. I neither accept this happiness, nor do I not accept this happiness. I neither accept this effortlessness, nor do I not accept this effortlessness. I neither accept this indescribable feeling of well-being, nor do I not accept this indescribable feeling of well-being. I neither accept this resolution, nor do I not accept this resolution. I neither accept this perfect harmony, nor do I not accept this perfect harmony. I neither accept the finality of this, nor do I not accept the finality of this. I neither accept the finality of this, nor do I not accept the finality of this. I neither accept the all-encompassing nature of this, nor do I not accept the all-encompassing nature of this. I neither accept the great relief of this, nor do I not accept the great relief of this. I neither accept the blessedness, nor do I not accept the blessedness. Wow. What is this? Oh, okay. Forget it. Text, you've used all your data. I neither accept data, nor do I not. I neither reject data, nor do I not reject data. Remember, data is something the continuity theory loves, so don't start out by saying I don't accept it. Say, I neither reject it, nor do I not reject it. I neither reject data, nor do I not reject data. I neither reject data, nor do I not reject data. People, some of the ego might say, well, what is your position? Well, I neither have a position, nor do I not have a position. Or I neither don't have a position, I neither reject having a position, nor do I not reject having a position. I neither reject technology, nor do I not reject technology. I neither accept freedom from technology, nor do I not accept freedom from technology. I neither accept freedom from death, nor do I not accept freedom from death. I neither accept freedom from self-delusion, nor do I not accept freedom from self-delusion. And of course, we're getting familiar. Every time we take a little step and do it, we get that adds to our bank account of familiarity. Every single practice, every time we say, you know, do this one of these little practices, we're putting some more money in the bank of familiarity. Absolutely we are. Making a deposit. And a video like this deposits a whole lot of capital in the account of familiarity. A lot. We can just say, wow, I made tremendous amount of money today on the spiritual stock market. I really made a great investment today. So, wow, look at the profits they're pouring in. But don't worry about counting. There'll be time enough for counting when the dealing's done. Gotta know when to hold them, know when to fold them, know when to run away, know when to run. You never count your chips when you're sitting at the table. There'll be time enough for counting when the dealing's done. So don't ever look for results. You know, don't try to measure, assess, or count yourself. Just keep practicing. Be aware of what your responses are. Okay, but don't try to get into measurement. Say, well, what does this mean in terms of how do I measure my progress or measure anything like that? Don't waste time on that. That's really, really throws a monkey wrench into everything. Because what we're really going for is familiarity. And the only way to do that is to keep practicing. As soon as we stop practicing to measure how much success we've had, we're losing on the opportunity to add more familiarity to our bank account. So, I neither reject the special relationship, nor do I not reject the special relationship. I neither reject bodies, nor do I not reject bodies. I neither reject this world, nor do I not reject this world. I neither reject all my struggles, nor do I not reject all my struggles. I neither accept leaving all the past behind, nor do I not accept leaving all the past behind. I neither accept leaving all the past behind, nor do I not accept leaving all the past behind. I neither accept this back getting well, nor do I not accept this back getting well. I neither accept this breakthrough, nor do I not accept this breakthrough. I neither accept this wonderful shift, nor do I not accept this wonderful shift. I neither accept this sublime glory, nor do I not accept this sublime glory. I neither accept this spiritual $1 trillion, nor do I not accept this spiritual $1 trillion. I neither accept this grace, nor do I not accept this grace. Okay? So, see, deep down we're saying, wow, 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 I never, ever even considered saying anything like this or believing, putting my attention on this. Never, 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 never thought of like this, you know. And so, at first you might get, you know, be defensive about it. Someone might get defensive about it. But gradually we lose our defensiveness and say, hey, I'm glad that I'm thinking about doing this and doing it. This is like a whole new realm, really, right, of practice. Wow. I neither believe nor do I not believe. I neither believe nor do I not believe. I neither accept this practice, nor do I not accept this practice. I neither believe in this practice nor do I not believe in this practice. Sometimes I neither reject this movie nor do I not reject this movie. So I neither reject this movie nor do I not reject this movie. I neither reject this dream nor do I not reject this dream. I neither reject this scheme, nor do I not reject this scheme. I neither reject this tiredness, nor do I not reject this tiredness. I neither accept liberation, nor do I not accept liberation. I neither accept infinite well-being, nor do I not accept infinite well-being. I neither accept the truth, nor do I not accept the truth. So we keep getting familiar. This is what wins. This is what wins. This is what wins. You know, you play a piano song 100 times, then when you play it at a recital or whatever, you know, it's like, you know, wow, no problem. Played it great. Everyone says, wow, that's easy for them. Someone else says, wow, I'm really smart. I'll play it twice. I get it. That's enough. They come to the recital. They start playing, and then they get in some traps. They start thinking about it. Say, wait, how do I do this again? How do I? People say, wow, they're really struggling with this song. It's difficult for them. So this is the difference, right? It's worth it. It's worth it. It's worth it. The extra practice is what makes all the difference. The extra practice is what tips the balance. Always. So we'll either be one that puts in the extra practice or one that does not. And the difference will show up very, very, very apparently. Right? Be very apparent. Either you're in abidance or you're convincing everybody, you know, how much you know about spirituality. It's, you know, one of the two. One of the two paths, you know. So the extra practice is what pays off. Given that it's sincere practice and not just say, well, I put in the time and I'll get the credits for that. You know, no, that's just an academic approach, trying to game the system. You know, given that the sincere effort, real honest and sincere, and you really say, I want to do this. This, I know this is helpful, so let me keep practicing. That's what tips the balance, makes the difference. We can say, I neither accept extra practice, nor do I not accept extra practice. I neither accept success, nor do I not accept success. I'm neither oriented towards success, nor am I not oriented towards success. All those little spiders at night, they're not around in the daytime. They only come out at night, these little spiders. What tough life. Make a web, gets destroyed. Make another web, gets destroyed. Make another web, gets destroyed. The spiders. There's one working right here. I see a big one working on building a web. What can they do? You know, they say, well, I got to eat. I got to build a web. Well, and either now some forms of the practice don't quite feel right, you know, right? So I neither reject building a web, nor do I not reject building a web. So you have to kind of put it in the right context. It may not always sound exactly right for you, but you can pretty easily do it. I neither reject being a web builder, nor do I not reject being a web builder. I neither reject being a web user, nor do I not reject being a web user. I neither reject technology, nor do I not reject technology. I neither reject the future, nor do I not reject the future. I neither reject the past, nor do I not reject the past. I neither feel the springtime, nor do I not feel the springtime. I was just feeling from flickers there of some perfect day, you know, some perfect idyllic day, like some sort of springtime day. So I neither experience the perfect day, nor do I not experience the perfect day. Ah, one moment. That's great. We got the practicing in now, because some service technician is coming out right now, you know, to try and deal with this problem. Who knows if it'll be fixed? This is ridiculous. It's been going on troubles. Is it, for me, if it's not broken, don't worry about trying to fix it. I mean, your phone's got some static on it. Is it for me? I just don't call tech people. I really do not, because they make it worse oftentimes. Really, they gave us a new remote for the TV. They said, oh, your old remote's not working so good. Here's a brand new one. Well, the brand new one works worse. It's a total hassle. Terrible. Unbelievable. I mean, we've been using remotes for how long now in the world? A long time. And this is the worst remote ever. It used to be 20, 30 feet, remote, boom. No problem with the remote. Now you got to go like 5 feet away and point it just in this perfect place and to adjust right. Otherwise, it doesn't work at all. Crazy. Crazy, absolutely crazy. That things get worse and worse and worse, and we're told they're getting better and better and better. And it's worse by design. There's a whole design to frustrate people in the world. Absolutely there is. These people who are trying to gain certain results are very, you might say, misanthropic in some ways, and the ends justify the means. Whatever means they feel will be effective, they say, well, it's okay then, because the end justifies whatever means they want to use. So if they want to intentionally try and dispirit everybody in the world, you know, they say, well, sure, why not? They say, if that works, let's try to dispirit everybody. And you can't help but feel like, you know, is there some sort of, you know, attempt to dispirit all of us and you know, it seems that way, doesn't it? Well, certainly through their own words, you would say that there is. But we put it into a practice. There's neither an attempt to dispirit us, nor is there not an attempt to dispirit us. There's neither conspiracies to dispirit us, nor is there not conspiracies to dispirit us. There's neither an attempt to draw us into war, nor is there not an attempt to draw us into war. Try that. You can use it on topical issues like this if you want, right? Absolutely. These tend to be a little more difficult because we tend to get more agitated about it. It's, you know, it's like, hey, how come the movies are so terrible? You know, there's neither an attempt to degrade us, nor is there not an attempt to degrade us. And we say, well, I know there is, but you know, that's not the practicing is what's important. Is, of course we know, but also we have to honor our efforts, you know, and the creativity involved in it. So put it into the practicing, neither nor practice, whatever it is, put it into that format, and you will find, you know, your inner landscape shifting for the better, changing for the better. This world is neither wicked, nor is it not wicked. This world is neither wicked, nor is it not wicked. This world is neither diabolical, nor is it not diabolical. This world is neither diabolical, nor is it not diabolical. I see, this is a little more difficult to practice in this way. It churns up more. Wow. Because we want to condemn. But we must be wise and practice neither nor. This is what really works. To what? So we can full stop in the now and feel perfect. Doesn't matter what the world does. That makes no difference what the world does, one way or the other. Doesn't affect our feeling perfect in the slightest bit. This is what our aim is. Isn't that a better aim than saying, I want the world to be the way I want it to be, and that's the only way I can be happy? Or isn't it better to say, doesn't matter what the world is, makes no difference what happens in the world, has no effect on how I feel whatsoever. That clearly is superior. Neither reject the future, nor do I not reject the future. I neither reject upset, nor do I not reject upset. I neither reject anger, nor do I not reject anger. Now, therapists can use this, really, they really can. But they have to realize what it's really aiming for it, and what the problem is when you do this, you'll start catching glimpses, dawning truth will begin to dawn upon us, and they're not really set up for to accept that, you know. So they'll say, whoops. having some sort of breakdown or something. How do you put that in practice? I'm not rejecting, I'm neither rejecting that I'm having a breakdown, nor am I not rejecting that I'm having a breakdown. It's like I say, I neither accept that I'm having a breakthrough, nor am I not accepting that I'm having a breakthrough. I neither accept that this is what I really want, nor am I not accepting that this is what I really want. I neither realize that this is what I really want, nor do I not realize that this is what I really want. neither accepting truth, nor am I not accepting truth. I'm neither accepting truth, nor am I not accepting truth. So we can go over and over practice we've already done to reinforce, reinforce, reinforce. So it becomes easier and easier and easier. We can go even go into abidance for the sake of practicing. Say, hey, you know, I'd like to practice with feeling abidance. So maybe we can, instead of saying, oh, I had this great breakthrough of abidance, this is it, this is it. We can say, you know, I'd really like to practice this neither nor practice in the context of abidance. So let's start abiding in the now. And I'll start practicing. I neither accept the abidance in now, nor do I not accept this abidance in now. Now that's really quite something, isn't it? Saying, sure, I'll accept abidance, but only for the purpose of practicing this neither nor. How about that? Is a nice intermediate step. So the step doesn't seem so big. So, yeah, so limit your abidance. I'm limiting it for the purpose of practicing. And then your continuity fear may say, okay to this. You know, I don't know. It's worth a try, isn't it? I've never thought of this before. It's worth a try. Wow. Don't try to prolong. Don't try to grab hold of it. Say, oh my gosh, I finally did it. I finally did. How do I keep this? How do I keep this? Oh my gosh, I don't want to lose this. Oh my gosh. Now go into a different context. Say, well, welcome, welcome abidance. I welcome you. And you're only here for the purpose of practicing this neither nor practice. As we've agreed upon that. So let's get practicing. Don't even think about how long, how can I keep this? Or how long can I keep this? Or how did I get this? Or why do I have this now? Or anything like that. Hey, you say, I know why you're here. You accept my invitation to be here to enable me to practice this. So I'm neither delighting in this, nor am I not delighting in this. I'm neither delighting in this, nor am I not delighting in this abidance. I neither accept the delight of abidance, nor do I not accept the delight of abidance. So we're not going to say, oh, this is the ultimate, this is it, this is the final. No, we say, no. This is just for the sake of practice here. And we'll practice and then we'll see how we feel after that. Maybe we'll invite it again or not. We're not thinking about that. We're just saying, okay, abidance is here, great. I neither accept this abidance being here, nor do I not accept this abidance being here. So hopefully our continuity fear, you know, we're getting on the same page now and we're saying, okay, there's a way to work this through together. I neither accept this feeling, nor do I not accept this feeling. So the videos are long for the sake of familiarity. It doesn't really help that much to just go over something and that's it. This is superficial at best. Superficial at best. And you see people their whole lives, they've just been, you know, skating on superficiality their whole lives, and they're getting old and they're saying, you know, wow, this is it, huh? Well, maybe I'll learn how to die properly, I'll study the Tibetan Book of the Dead, and I'll try to think of good loving thoughts when I die, and maybe that's it. And we've all, you know, been there and done that. But this here is not superficial. You know, this is really getting to it. Because now we're talking about negotiating. Ah, there we go again. Full stop on the wow. Yeah, service technicians. Maybe they can come and make things even worse. You know, mess up the computer, mess up the phones, mess up the fax, mess up everything. You know, there's probably more likelihood that'll happen than they'll get it fixed, you know? Really. And it's incredible how vulnerable we feel now because, you know, how easy it is for us to lose connection now. Some service person, I'll make it better. I'll put a new box, blah, blah, blah. And then nothing works. Doesn't work. Can't do anything, you know. We're cut off from the world. We're cut off from everything. It's really scary. I really just don't like it at all. But I say, well, I neither dislike technology, nor do I not dislike it. I neither dislike technology, nor do I not dislike technology. Okay. Put it in that neutral form. Whatever you're feeling, put it in a neutral form. If it's a positive feeling, put it in a neutral form. If it's a negative feeling, put it in a neutral form. Don't get in the polarity of positive and negative feelings. Don't get into that. So if I'm feeling, you know, bliss, I'm neither accepting this bliss, nor am I not accepting this bliss. If we're angry, we say, I neither reject this anger, nor do I not reject this anger. So it's a negative feeling. Start out with I neither reject this, nor do I not reject it, okay? Because it lets the continuity fear feel comfortable. If it's a positive feeling, say, start out with, I neither accept it. I neither accept this happiness, nor do I not accept this happiness. I neither accept this carefreeness, nor do I not accept this carefreeness. If it's negative, I neither reject this depression, nor do I not reject this depression. I neither reject this depression, nor do I not reject this depression. I neither reject this anxiety, nor do I not reject this anxiety. We're getting up there in the time department here, aren't we? Yeah. That's great. That's great. Getting a full video in here. Full familiarity is what really, 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 really moves us along. And we have to do that now because we're running out of time in terms of the polarity game here is going to get too intense. This is the trouble. It's already, I mean, just watching the baseball playoffs, you see the commercials, and it is just so insane. So insane. I mean, the mentality of the world is going down the toilet. And the polarity game is getting very, very intense indeed. And the distractions are getting so intense, and it's just, wow. I really can hardly watch the baseball. It's so horrible. You just feel that this is something terrible is taking place here. It's worse than terrible. So I thought, well, I neither reject this something terrible, nor do I not reject this something terrible. So you can still practice it. If anything comes up, if it's a negative, Okay, see, I neither reject the negative, nor do I not reject it. But it's a positive. See, I neither accept this positive, nor do I not accept it. Very simple, right? Easy. See how easy we've gotten it now. So whatever I'm feeling, am I feeling blah, well, I neither reject this blahness, nor do I not reject this blahness. Or, oh, this is great. Well, I neither accept how great this is, nor do I not accept how great this is. And you say, oh, I just love the way this is going. You say, well, I neither accept that I neither accept that I love the way this is going, nor do I not accept that I love the way this is going. So you can always put it into a practice. Practice putting it into a practice form. This is what's really important. Say, how do I put this into a form I can practice with? Well, this is what we're smoothing out here. This is a very powerful practice in terms of right now. Right now, right here, right now, and this was this polarity game goes shifts into, quantum overdrive and just gets completely. I mean, I'm not following the news, which is very smart. But a little bit dribbles through here and there, just the way our lifestyles are right now, unless we want to live in a cave, somehow it'll dribble through. But I don't dig into anything. It's just like, oh, I neither accept this, nor do I not accept it. Oh, another shooting. Oh, I neither reject this shooting, nor do I not reject this shooting. All right? I mean, it seems like there's a shooting. I don't know. It seems like every day, every day, every day, or some campus, some, I mean, this is all being orchestrated at a certain level of our consciousness, right? Absolutely. Of course, everything is. Nothing happens by accident. It's all harmonious orchestration, depending on our continuity fear, where our continuity fear is at. So,